console.
What happened with the audio for the video?
Oh, it's good.
It's good now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. Thank you very much. Yeah, I think so. He'll be back right back. Hey, how are you, sir?
Hello. Happy New Year. How are you?
Good. Good to see you again.
Good.
Those of you here, hopefully there'll be 12 of you. And then there are supposed to be 4 people in Palm Beach Gardens. Can you folks hear me in Palm Beach Gardens? Great. I see 2 of you, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, great. 2 out of 4, 50%. Not a good batting average maybe, but we'll try our best. 2, 4, 6, 8 out of 12. So 67%. So they're winning down here, okay? So I hope that everybody knows that when we start a class, we like to do it right on time, because that's really the best courtesy for everybody. So what I'd like to do, without too much in the way of technical stuff, because we're going to go into that, you'll see the introduction, the agenda that we have. I'd like to introduce Dr. Fred Forgy. He is the director of the MISRED program, and I think he has a few words for everybody. Dr. Fred.
Absolutely, thank you. Well, good evening, everybody. No one had any difficulty finding the place, I guess. All was good. All right, well, what I'm going to do is just give a very quick kind of introduction from the standpoint of giving you a little bit of information about the program that you may not be aware of, just kind of a few nuts and bolts so that you kind of understand where things are happening and what's happening, and if you've got any questions, and I hopefully can answer those questions. So kind of running through my little list I have up here, the first thing I mentioned to a few of you, parking. You can get the parking pass over at Horvitz, one of the buildings here on campus. All you need to do is just sort of show up there. They open early in the morning and stay open relatively late. Pick up that as soon as possible. That will allow you to obviously park, you know, in one of the student lots or in the garage. Second, your ID card, you can pick up that at the Student Center, which is just past the library here on campus. And with that, that will allow you to access the parking garages as well as be able to use the library here on campus. Now, as for textbooks, I don't see if any of you have the book for this class or not, but just kind of as a matter of practice, we do supply the bookstore with information about what textbooks that we're using, but chances are you can probably find the books a lot less expensive online if you go to Amazon or eBay and can probably pick them up at probably close to half the price. So, certainly, you know, make your choices there as you need to. Now, most of the instructors will be sending out the books in terms of what books are going to be using along with their syllabi early on, you know, usually a week or so prior to the beginning of the semester via email. So make sure you're paying attention to that. You go ahead and grab those. Make sure that you have them for the first day of class. One of the things to sort of take note of with regard to email, that is the only way we have to communicate with you is via the NOVA email. So if for whatever reason you have difficulty accessing that, what I would suggest you do, what most people tend to do that works best, is to set it up on your phone, if you can, as an exchange account. That will allow it to be automatically sent there, and you can get the messages as soon as they're received. One of the things I will point out, we've had a couple of instances of where whenever we as instructors send out emails to you as students, in a couple of instances they will end up in your spam folder, okay? Make sure that you check your spam folder on a regular basis just to make sure that isn't happening or that you're not missing an email from us, okay, for whatever reason. Next thing, you will be needing a financial calculator for the program, and the one that we consistently use is the Hewlett-Packard 10B. That calculator, once again, available in a variety of places. I've seen it as cheap as $15 on eBay and as expensive as probably $30. So just depending on the time of the year, usually this time of the year it's a little bit more expensive because it's the beginning of the semester, but usually by the middle of the semester it's gone down in price a little bit. You will need a laptop that you'll be able to bring to class with Microsoft Excel. Doesn't matter whether it's a Mac or a PC, but you will need to have a laptop. Now, if you are taking one of the Argus courses, then you will need to install Parallels or VMFusion to be able to allow you to run a PC-based operating system to be able to use Argus. But if you're not taking one of the Argus classes this semester, that's not going to be an issue, okay? And if you aren't able to install the VMFusion or Parallels on your Mac, I can loan you a PC-based laptop to be able to install the software on it. One of the things that you may or may not be aware of, we videotape every single class, okay? And as soon as the class is over, we typically take that recording and upload it to YouTube, typically within the next 24 hours. And the way you access it is simply go to youtube.com and search for MSREE, and that will pull up all the videos for the program, and they are sequenced by class title as well as by date, so that you can literally look for the past year and a half at every single course that has been delivered in the program and pull up that information and see it. And so this allows you that in the event that you maybe need to miss class, or you come in late, or you know you have to leave early, or you know whatever the issue is, you can always be able to refer back to that as to you know, what took place, or something that was really complicated, was covered in class, you didn't quite get it while you were there. It's a great resource, and folks tend to love being able to kind of go back and review that information online. One of the things that we do, and we'll kind of get into this as we, get a little further into the program, is we will be sponsoring you to attend a handful of professional conferences, typically associated with the professional associations, the Urban Land Institute, National Association of Industrial Office Properties, ICSC, the International Council of Shopping Centers, and a handful of others. We will be paying for your admission to these conferences that will be held typically here within the region. So that's something to sort of keep in mind as you sort of move on through the program. With that, we also will be paying for your memberships to ULI, NAOP, and ICSC, and that will entitle you to not only go to these conferences, but they also have special networking events that occur throughout the year. There are a lot of sort of meet and greet kind of events, and they're great ways to meet up with alumni of the program, other students within the program, but also professionals outside of the university setting for prospective internships, jobs, whatever it might be, okay? So they're an incredible opportunity there to meet up with folks. Now, one of the things that both ULI and NAOP have are a young leaders component to it, which is a special category for folks typically under the age of 35 that tends to focus on those folks that really want to get very actively involved in the industry. It's a great way to kind of, once again, network and get involved with people that are just sort of starting out in the industry. One of the things that we started this past year is a student group here among the real estate development students. And the folks that are in the Saturday cohort currently are the members of that organization. You guys obviously will be joining them. And the idea behind the student group is that you will be jointly sponsoring guest speakers. You will be setting up site visits and study tours that will be, in some cases, outside of the traditional time period that you're set to meet in class. A great way for you to sort of, once again, network and get to meet the other folks in the program. in addition to you guys sitting here, there's a group of about 25 students that meet in the Saturday program, in the Saturday cohort. So the idea, I mean, while you are going to be separate, you will have the opportunity to sort of integrate with them to the extent that you want to, okay? One of the things that you may or may not be aware of is you are eligible to take Saturday classes, okay? So if you want to mix and match and you want to sort of say, I want to take a Tuesday night class and a Saturday class, you can do that, okay? You may not have been told that, no, and that's okay. It's just, you know, an issue that most of you probably have a strong preference that maybe you want to go in the evenings and not on Saturdays, and so that's fine. But that is an option that's available to you. Okay, I just want to make sure that you're aware of that. One of the things, after you kind of get through this class successfully, we will be assigning you mentors, okay? And these are folks that are preeminent players within the commercial real estate development market within South Florida. You can kind of get a sense for who these folks are by taking a look at the website in terms of our advisory board. Folks like Terry Stiles, Harry Posen, Eric Swanson, and a handful of others that will work with you one-on-one in terms of sort of career mentorship, okay? And we'll explain more of that kind of as you get a little bit deeper into the program. More mentioned about the emails, study tours and site visits. As is the case with this particular course, there will be a handful of site visits outside of the classroom where we'll be going out to actual, whether it's construction sites or finished project sites, meeting with typically the developer responsible for that project or architect responsible for the project or others that are in some way affiliated, responsible with the project, to give you a chance to hear what they have to say about the project, but also for you to be able to ask very, you know, detailed questions about how they did what they did, what the challenges were that they faced, you know, how did they structure the financing for the deal, you know, those kinds of things. Okay, make sense? All right, so that's a very, very quick kind of and dirty overview of the basic sort of administrative things. Is there any of that that you have any questions about? The site visits are just whenever they get set up. If most of the time what tends to happen is, at least within the classroom setting, like in Mark's class, this class that you're taking, there will be at least two or three site visits that you guys will be doing in this course where you'll be going from here to those sites during class time. Same thing for the Saturday cohort. There will be site visits that they will be going on that you are welcome to join and theoretically vice versa. But there may also be additional sort of site visits, speakers, that sort of thing, that the student group may set up outside of normal class time. It might be like a Wednesday night or some other, you know, time of the week to potentially, you know, allow you, you know, to interact with each other and to obviously go in and visit some other particular project or person. Okay, anybody else? Okay,
great. Thank you, Dr. Forty.
All right.
That's a good introduction. And what we'll do now is, in fact, I just want to make sure that I know who's here. So I'm going to do a very, very brief attendance. And so I'm going to look to the folks in Palm Beach Gardens. And as I see only two of you right now, I'm going to ask, is Rick Curtis there? No. So I'm going to guess that you're Jason Krause. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. He raises his hand. Everybody here can see on the screen. And so now I have a 50-50 chance. Are you Alexandra Hall?
That's correct.
Oh, well, okay, great.
Alexandra Hall.
Okay, great. So the two others, maybe they'll walk in a little bit later. Great, thank you. So if you see Diogenes or Rick, have them wave wildly and we'll do our thing here. So let me just make sure I asked everybody here to get a name card that will help me to remember who you are, because you only have one face to look at this evening and I have, well, I have theoretically 16 or so as well. And so I will give everybody an opportunity to introduce themselves a little bit later in the class and stand up and give me your elevator pitch. So that's just like a little advance warning. Same for the folks in Palm Beach Gardens also. And so I want to just make sure I get this right. So I see Christian Asiro is there. Okay, as I say the names for my benefit too. Gaon, is that right? Gaon Bramrow. Antoine. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
That's the easy part. The last name's harder. Dada Sayed?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Jordan Finkelman.
Yes.
Great. Back there, Chanel. Did I say that correctly?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. And correct me if I'm wrong. So I see that Piedad is not here. Bridget? Yes, hi. Chelsea? Chelsea Newberry. Dustin? Ogska?
Ogska.
Ogska, okay, fine. Thank you. Daniela Herrera? Okay. Harold Riley? Oh, there you are, right there. Charlin? Charlin Rodriguez. Chantel? Hi, hi. And you are?
Daniel Fernando.
Well, okay, great. Why don't you take that name tag that's back there for you? Great. And grab a seat next to Christian, right here. Now, the row in front. But bring yourself up a little bit closer. We'll get you organized a little bit better. And who's this walking in?
Rosie.
Okay. All right. Well, great. So, okay, so what we're going to do right now, actually, we'll jump and we'll get to know each other a little bit better. As we move through the course, I'd like to introduce Susan Berman, and she is a subject specialist in business library at the Alvin Sherman Library. We're going to turn over to her the next part of our presentation, because for me and for every other good real estate professional, it's all about the resources, it's all about the tools that you can use in the profession that will make you smarter, better, faster, sharper, whatever it is. You may not be able to fly, but at least you'll be able to think through what it is that we do here. So we're going to switch our computer and get you onto this one. Put this to the side momentarily. And hopefully we've got that up on the screen. And so Susan's going to talk to us about all the different items. By all means, take notes. By the way, I will mention that I like technology, and there's a time to use it, and there's a time not to use it. Certainly when you're listening to her, those of you who do have your computers, and I did ask you to bring a computer or tablet, then if you want to cruise the websites while she's telling you and teaching you, this is a perfect opportunity to do so. Is that correct?
That's fine.
Right, great. Okay, Susan, you're on. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Susan Berkman. I am the research specialist and business specialist for the business school. So I support all the programs for the business school. I do collection development, the books that we buy, the databases that we help support for you to use come from the library, and that's my role here. So I'm the liaison between the library and the school. If you find there's stuff you need, there's a way to do that and ask for it. Okay, so I'm going to walk you through the library's new redesigned homepage. Of course, it's new for the semester, so I'm getting used to a couple of things as well, so we're kind of all new at it. Just also, there's a sign-in sheet that is being passed around, so make sure everybody signs in, because we keep statistics too. Okay, so this is the library's homepage. It's now sherman.library.nova.edu. I strongly suggest you bookmark this page, because you're going to go back to it all the time. I can't tell you how many times people are like, oh, I don't know, where am I, and they make a call in there. So, I mean, you can get to it from nova.edu. If you do not do this. Okay, so if you're at Nova's homepage, you can go on your research, and then click on libraries and learn more, and then you'll get into libraries. We are the Alvin Sherman Library, which is right next door. You're the closest building to it. Don't be a stranger. We also have three other libraries as part of Nova's campus. There's the Health Profession Division Library, which is on over where the health services are. The Law School Library, also next door the other way. And then the Oceanographic Center has its own library as well. Okay, so just so you know, there is another way to get there. So some of the things that are new, now you have the hours of the library. We are open a lot. We're open 7 days a week. Okay, we were even open during the break when the school was closed, because we are a joint use facility with Broward County Library. So on the first floor, there's it's like almost like a public library when you first walk, you walk straight in. So if you're looking for non-academic things, There's, that's where the bestsellers are, all children's books, young adults, magazines, popular magazines, newspapers, videos, games, all kinds of stuff, Blu-rays, so, you know, there's some fun available for you too in that center. Okay, so I also want to point out here, this is something I want you, if you remember nothing else tonight about, is Ask a Librarian. This tells you when we're open, so we are open until 9 o'clock on 8 p.m. on Saturdays, so you can stop in and see us on the reference area on the second floor. You can call us, you can email us, you can do chat. I suggest if you have a long, involved question, you don't use that mode, because usually we have people standing in front of us answering the phone and doing everything at the same time in chat, so that's only good for quick ones. But this is important too, this appointment request form. So you can schedule a one-on-one with a librarian for 30 minutes to 60 minutes. And you just fill out this form, tell us what you need, what you've done already, and then you fill out what days and times you're available. We bend over backwards to be available, so we will meet with you in person. If you can't come in person, we can do it with you on GoToMeeting. We can do it online. We've Skyped. I've talked with students in South Korea at 10 o'clock at night from home, you know, when it's 11 o'clock over there in the morning. So we're pretty available. So take advantage of that. I don't know how many of you are new to Nova. Are you?
Who's new?
New to Nova.
All right, just about everybody.
Almost everybody.
Great.
Okay. And how many of you haven't been in school for a while? Okay, so.
We have a mature crowd.
I'm specifically talking to a lot of you because I've had people that have been out for a lot longer than probably some of you have, and they're just like freaking out. Do not freak out. We are here to help you. I'm in a group of 16 other reference librarians that can help. And if it's business, you will probably get referred to me. You can request me if you like. But we have other people that can help as well. So just know that we're here to help you.
Any questions so far? You had a question?
Yeah, just for the Wi-Fi. Is there a Wi-Fi code for the NSU?
In fact, there are a couple of Wi-Fis. You should probably just go to NSU Guest.
Guest,
if
I was
going
to say. Yeah.
Because the limited access never seems to work. Hopefully
yeah.
With Guest here online, are you? You will be shortly, I'm sure.
Okay, so any other questions about our availability? Yes?
I think I missed the part where you said where the library is located. Is it the same one that is combined between Broward College and FAU?
No. It is the building right next door. If you walk out of, not facing the garage they're going out, but if you went out the other entrance, it's literally next door. You see the Miniachi Performing Arts Center, it's connected to that on your way to the student center. Campus. And it's a beautiful building, so it's really worth your while to go in there. A lot of good artwork. Okay, so that's really what I want you to remember today. We're here to help you. Okay, so we're going to work our way around this new page. This is our catalog. It says catalog right here. We call it NovaCat. And this is where you're going to look for, if you were looking for books on a topic, magazines, periodicals, things, just to see if we have anything on a topic, right? So we're going to, let's just put in real estate since that's what you're here for.
When was the last time anybody actually stepped into a library? Anybody here do that recently? Because there are good reasons to step into one too, and even though we now know Susan on the online basis, sometimes you can actually get resources there too. So I'm just trying to encourage you in every way, shape, and form.
I'm going to tell you also, there's a lot of things, and we have an unbelievable programming for a university library because we're also connected with the county. There's an art gallery there that has an exhibit almost all the time, so it rotates out different things. And all these programs that they do there are free. So when you're looking to take a break, or you just, and we'll cover some of the other reasons why you can be there too for study. Okay, so we put in real estate and we got 1,988 results, but I want to point out some of the things here. Okay, so here's a book. It says it's an e-book. So there's a couple of things learned here. You learn the year of the book. You can see that it's an e-book, which means it's not going to have a call number or where it's located, because you'll be able to click right here on this link and it will take you to the book. Okay? We, depending on how popular we think a book's going to be, we usually get on e-books just we buy one for one user at a time, so you may get a thing saying it's being used. But if we find that it's some books we have multiple users access, so more than one of you can access it at the same time, you can keep trying to do that. But you could actually read the book online. Some of them are downloadable as well. So you can actually do it on your mobile devices and take it with you. We normally, as a collection development policy, do not buy textbooks. You can tell us the first week of school, because I was on the reference test today. I don't know how many of those have been in this book. And you know it's a textbook. Because you don't want to compete with the bookstore or the other avenues for you to get it. We may have an older edition of a textbook, but just know that it's an older edition. Okay? Okay, so there's a couple of things. Okay, so the e-book. Now here's location. So it's gonna this one, this particular book, well, let's pick one that's actually about real estate. Okay, so here's one, and it says it's at the law library. And it's on the, and this one's on the student collection, which means no, you're not going to find it next door at Sherman. You have to go to the law library to use it. You probably can't take it out at the law school. Just telling you that.
Just for safety, remember it's the search criteria is real estate development?
Just real estate, I put
okay.
it. Yeah, I made it simple.
Okay.
Yeah, development will get less than we did, but I want to just point out some of the things you should be looking for when you do a search for this. So we're going to look at location, we're going to look at the year of the book, whether there's a call number, whether the status. So here is a book, it's in the Sherman Library. There's a call number that you're going to want to write down or take a picture of with your phone when you're there, because that's going to be tell you where it's located, what floor. And then the availability, which means this is it's on the shelf, it should be on the shelf, and you should be able to take it out. This one is a government document. Here's one, real estate development, and it's available here. And this one's another an e-book. Let's see what else we got here. Okay, this one was taken out, but was recently returned, which means it may not be on the shelf yet. This one's at the law library. So you kind of get the idea here, okay? You can add terms to find out what's going on. It'll tell you what library, whether it's available, or if it's, you know, if there says here I'm due with a date, that means someone has it out. So any questions about that? It's pretty simple, but just, you know, I can't tell you how many times people came in and they said, oh, I can't find this book. And, you know, a lot of times, you know, they'll go look on the shelf and it's because it's not even in our library. It's at the law library or it's at somewhere else. If we do not have a book that you want, you can do an interlibrary loan. I'm going to show you how to do that. So for that, you would go down here. Under borrow, there is a form for interlibrary loan. ILiAD is, that's what it's called, interlibrary loan. When you click on that, you have to log in. That's why you need your Shark ID. Okay, that's one of the reasons you're going to need to get one. Because you won't be able to get anything online from the library without it, besides getting into the parking garage. When you fill this out, there's a form. If you request, if you have a book through, let me go back to the books. So let's take a physical book. Okay. When you're here, you can, if you want, if you're coming to campus that day or in the next couple of days, you can hold a book for pickup. So if it's also out, you can also put a hold on a book. And then you'll get an email sent to you when it's back, when it's in the library, and you have it 3 or 4 days or 5 days, I'm not sure the time period,
come pick it up here, okay? If you are a distance student, you can request it for delivery. You can, they will send it to you for free, but if you want to, when you send it back, you have to pay the postage, okay? You can add it to your list, you can send it to your phone, you can do all these things. So if you don't have a book, again, go back to that interlibrary loan form and it will fill in, you can fill in the information about the book. So if you found it on Amazon or you have a textbook or whatever and you want to see if we can get it for you, it will take up to 2 weeks to get a book. So keep that in mind. If you articles can be sooner, and they'll send them to you electronically if that's available. But don't wait till the night before and think you're going to get it tomorrow, because that's not going to happen. Okay. Any questions about that? Okay, so we're going to, before we get into searching, I want to point out a couple of other things here. So this full text finder does not really mean that you're looking necessarily for full text. So it's a little bit of a misnomer, but that's what the company's calling it. This is where you want to know if we have a particular journal or newspaper or magazine and where it might be. Okay, so say you want to know if we have like the New York Times, right? See the little arrow thing hovering up there. So you're going to put in a title. This is not for books, this is for journals and magazines. And you're going to go down to the New York Times. And this will tell you which databases we have it in and which dates we have available. So if you wanted to, I know some of these are better than others. So I'm going to go to ProQuest Newsstand Complete here. And you're going to sign in with your Shark ID and password. Took me to the right page. That's weird. So here's today's issue. You would click on that and you can read today's paper. What you can do though for any publication is if you go back to this, you know, so here's full text from today's. If there's some publication that you want to read on a regular basis and you want to, you know, maybe you don't have time every day to do it, or you want to, they say it's a monthly publication, whatever, you can set up an alert or create an RSS feed. So it'll be sent to you every day, and then you can open up the link and follow it that way.
So let me just intervene briefly. I am going to ask, and we'll go through it after her presentation, where everybody should ideally have their own subscription to the Times and the Wall Street Journal. She's making an example of the New York Times, and it's great because there's a lot of archived information here. But this is not just for the New York Times. It's really for any major or lesser publication within the, you know, the business world, the real estate world, the entire world. And that's the beauty of this kind of resource and this access on ProQuest. So.
Okay, so if we were going to do another example and you want to see what was real estate here. So it's not, we're not looking for newspaper, we're looking for any magazines or periodicals that might have real estate. This is acting
good.
Oh, it's on the
catalog.
Oh, it did?
Yeah.
Thank you. I thought everything was just going on me today. Okay. So these are all the journals and titles that have it in their title. So there may be other ones that don't have it in their title and called like land use or urban development, and that's not going to show up in this list, but these, you know, just so you have an idea of how to use this. And if we click on, okay, so here's a magazine called Real Estate Issues. And if this is something you want to keep up to date with, pick one that has it to present and then just set one of those alerts up for yourself so you can get it sent to you when it comes out. Sometimes you'll have, you'll be doing research and in the back in your references, you're going to have a, you know, maybe they're talking about another article that you want to read, right? But you don't know if we have it. You would then put in the title of the journal. That's the big mistake people make. They usually put in, someone say, I'm putting in the title of the article. That's not how you look. You look for the journal, and then you look for the specific issue. Okay, so that's when this becomes really useful for you. Okay, any questions about that? Okay. Google Scholar. Another one of, we know you're going to use it. Okay, but we're going to get into databases here, and I'm hoping you're going to use those more. In the back, I have three reasons why you should, if you're going to use Google Scholar, do it through our library page, because if it's something that we have here, it's going to show up that it's here already. So sometimes if you, you know, you've been asked to look for scholarly and peer-reviewed articles, maybe not in this class, but in some of your other classes, peer-reviewed, you don't know if it's peer-reviewed if you do it on Google Scholar. When you use our databases, you will know that it's peer-reviewed because you're going to check that box. So that's adding an extra step for you. But if you want to know if it's something that we have when you go to Google Scholar, instead of looking at this article here, and saying, oh, I wonder if we have that book or something, and then you have to go back into the catalog and research it, you'll know right here, there's a link on the right-hand side that it's already here. So that's why if you're gonna use it through our site. Did everybody get that? I see a little on the Zoom, not so sure. Look. So, you're reading it, you know, you did your search, right? In Google Scholar, you're not going to get anything on that right-hand side. That all those little links are not going to show up. So you're not going to know whether we have it or not. So now you're going to have to go back into that full text finder or the catalog or whatever, then look up the book, look up the article, look up and see if we have it. If you do it on our website, it's already connected. So you're going to go here and know that there's, you know, here's the article. Just to make it simple. Trust me, it's there. Okay. APA. How many people get nervous when they hear that? Nobody?
Everybody knows what it is, right, folks?
You guys are all experts,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, in case you're not, we have a lot of tools to help you. So, if you want to know how to cite a journal article, we now have this new tab here that will take you to this, as well as other things. So here's a journal article without a DOI, with a DOI, case study, and lots of different examples, and there's more to it than that. This is just one simple area for you. I'm going to show you some other tools that we have to help you with that as well.
Sure. Since it's there, we don't need the book, right?
No, you need the book.
We still need it.
That is worth your investment. I mean, I don't think it's not an expensive book, but you're going to use it throughout your entire career here. Almost every, there's a couple of, I think Ocean doesn't use APA, I think they use Chicago, and maybe one of the other groups uses a different style, but if you're in the business school, you're using APA.
The most important thing to realize is that you need to have a standard. And when you get out in the business world, there may be a different standard, but here we use APA, and that at least gives you the discipline to start with a particular way of doing things, of documenting your papers, of looking at resources, because original research and the work that you present is going to be very important, and also will demonstrate to your future employers that you know how to not only find the information, but document it in a way that shows that it's your thinking, it's your work product, and that's going to put you in an advantage.
Does the APA populate a different type of citation online than the one in the book?
No. It's, what we have here is, there's multiple tools to help you. There's the book. We have this website. There's a library guide that I'm going to show you. We have workshops. I'm going to show you about those too. So there's a lot of help. You can schedule a one-on-one library appointment to do APA work if you need to. Okay? So we, whatever you're, you know, doing, if you're having trouble with a subject, if you're having trouble, we will not tell you if something is correct or not. I mean, that's not our job. Some people come and say, is this right? That's not our role. We can show you how to find how to do it right. Okay? So it's between you and your professor. We're not going there. Okay? Any questions about that? There's a lot of opportunities to get help. So I'm going to show you some of those too. So I'm going to skip right now to these work that's under help. This is where we offer workshops. In the back also, I have this handout. I suggest you take one on the way out because it covers a lot of the workshops. January 20th, there is actually an APA workshop at 8 p.m. It's a Wednesday night. It's online. You don't even have to come in, okay? But there's other ones too. We're doing a bunch of ones on research writing and some other things. And from what I've seen, probably everyone can use a little help with that. But if you look at upcoming workshops, so here's one coming up just this week on navigating the library's new homepage. So if you forget anything today, besides going back to this particular recording that they're doing tonight, there's one for those too. It's only a half hour. You could be doing it at lunch hour at work. Gear up. Oh, these gear up ones are actually, these are NSU libraries workshops that actually I'm the chair of this committee. We have put together a lot of really interesting workshops geared towards the faculty, as well as the staff and the students. So there's a lot of cool things coming up. There's one on getting grant money coming up soon, so that may be of interest to you. So scroll through these and see what's coming up, because there's a lot. And I'm going to put a plug in right here now. Also, there's also a handout in the back. January 28th, we're having a full day, 9 to 3:30, of four academic publishers that are coming to campus to talk about publishing a case study, publishing open access, publishing a technical paper, and then Thompson Ward is going to be here talking about EndNote and some other things that they have for you. There's different sessions concurrently. You can come in person. There's actually a free lunch because the vendors are sponsoring it, and breakfast. And you can register also to attend it online. And if you can't do any of that, you can schedule to get the recordings. So I'm really throwing that out there. We've had a really interesting, it's the first time we've done anything like this. And it's my thing, so I'm really pushing it. So please, and share that with your friends. This is actually open to people outside of Nova as well. We have people coming from other universities, Baptist Health, some other things out there. So take advantage of those workshops. And if you ever have an idea, something that you think would be good for a workshop, please let us know, because we mix it up every semester. Okay, any questions about that? Okay, I want to also point out here about study rooms, because sometimes you just want to little place to study. The library is loaded with them. We have lots of rooms, different sizes. So if you're working in a group, if you want, there's four-person rooms, eight-person rooms, 10-person rooms, but the four-person room is really like for two people, you know, one to two or whatever, and it goes on. And then you have, now they have this new policy, which I've never saw before. So I'm going to acknowledge that and then go to the schedule. Okay, so this is what it looks like. So during the day, there's obviously more options, but since we're later in the day, so this will tell you what's open, and then you can click on it and put your reservation in. And then, just so you know, you can schedule up to 2 weeks out. So when it gets study time and cram time, and you're like, you know, freaking out because there's no rooms available, although during study, heavy study times, we actually have snacks in the library, at night, Cookie Man comes. And Just know that you can schedule it 2 weeks out in advance. And also, I want to point out, we just last semester at the very end opened up a collaborative study room on the third floor. You cannot go in there by yourself. You have to be in a collaborative group, and you guys usually have a group project in here. And I'm sure you will in your other courses as well. It's a great place. It's a huge open room with a ton of light, and they have tables with the technology set up with, you know, you can share a monitor with 5 people, 6 people. And no food or drink allowed in there, but it's a great place to work as a group and make noise and not be kicked out for the things. Any questions about that? Okay. So I think I have covered most of the on you here. We have library.
Susan, there's a question over here.
Oh, sure. I'm sorry.
Would you happen to have conference rooms as well, like in case students want to make a meeting or something of that sort?
You can request a room. There, the way to do that is. Reserve a room under services. So what I did was click on this little hamburger up here. Reserve a room, and you, so there's this, here's actually a picture of this beautiful collaborative study room. I mean, it's really beautiful. And here, as you can see, there's a monitor here and all kinds of stuff. And then there's separate rooms in there to study, the conference rooms. So students can reserve, you know, this is where you have to contact to do that. So one of the other things we have to help you, and then we'll get into it part, are these library learn videos here under, this is again for help. So we've done a lot of short videos on how to, like checking for peer-reviewed articles using OLWorks Web, creating a database account, finding articles in the particular journal, how's finding books and more in the library catalog. All these different things are short little videos. So in case you forget anything, you know, it's another place to go, and it's like midnight and the reference desk is closed and you're just starting to study, there's some places for you to get some help, you know, so you don't have to wait till the next day. So we have it broken down into getting started, different things on research. Things like that. And then again, here's some videos on APA, again, for you to, another resource for you to get information on that. Okay, we also have library guides. These are, so there's a couple of different ones. The one that you go to often will be this writing and citation style guide. So you see that there is one for APA. And this is a really excellent guide for how to, for electronic references, APA formatting, citing and text. How do I cite? And then here's all these different things. How do I do all the different websites and blogs and legal stuff and whatever. And then there's a great example. So 9 times out of 10, they will also, besides showing you the guide, they're going to show you what page it's on in the book. So if you need even more information, so everything's kind of all cross-reference for you. It's just very simple, how handy for you right there on the site. APA for beginners gets even more basic. Some of the video tutorials are here as well. So just click on these links and you should be able to get into it. And then we also send you to, I believe, there's a link to Purdue OWL, which has a lot of great questions and answers on APA and the APA blog, so you'd be APA experts in no time. We also have subject guides. So if one goes to business and economics, and then goes to business sources at the Alvin Sherman Library. This one was redone last year. So this is, but you don't know where to go, and we're gonna start talking about databases in a minute, right? So we have close to 500 databases here at NOVA. The reason you want to use them is because this stuff's already been vetted for you, okay? It's scholarly, it's the news things, it's not a crapshoot on what you found on Google or what you found on Bing or what you found on DuckDuckGo, whatever it is. Okay, this is stuff, this is academic. We've spent thousands of dollars on these databases. If you don't use them, we lose them. So use them. Because when we've gone through cuts, some of the things that are really useful, you know, when you say the usage is up, we say we can't cut that. So, and then I have to fight for all my business people to keep what I want to keep. So it's really important to use them. Okay, so there's some general ones on this first page, and again, the workshops are going to be listed here as well. And there's some business ebooks, so these are collections of business ebooks. It's not just a particular book. Some general business websites, some general business periodicals to go to. And then we have it broken down into, under home, we have other information. So if you need to get company and industry information, here are some sites and databases to use there. The same thing for demographics and statistical information, dissertation resources, and market research. Under how to, again, it gets you into APA and evaluating resources and EndNote. That's another resource for you. And then under each of the disciplines within the business school, we have new, you know, books that we get in. So I've just been updating some of these, although this doesn't look like it updated the things that I put in here. So that's interesting, a couple of them. Periodicals in this discipline, websites, and I'm going to be updating some of these because it's actually this database is not really correct to be here. And you'll see throughout all the other disciplines here, the same thing. So they're all set up the same way. Some databases specific for that discipline, new books that we've gotten in, you know, websites, periodicals, and then the programs. So this is a good, if you're not sure where to go, this is a good place to start sometimes. Any questions about that? Okay. So now, let's get into the main part of databases. So this is something new, the way it's now designed on the web page. Okay. If you know a specific database you want to go to, you can click on database by name, and then here's a list of all of them. It's very long, or you can start typing in a name at the top here, and then it'll start producing that. But we try to make it easier for you, and we divide things into subjects so that not everything is going to be within that subject. There's a lot of cross-reference, but most of what you'll need is so that at least you can start someplace, and we're going to start with business, okay? So here's 67 just under business alone, okay? So that's why you're not going to go to Google Scholar all the time. So let's do a couple of searches and show you what kind of things we're going to get. So this is these are top picks. It doesn't mean this is the best one. It just means that there's a couple of things here you're going to find I think really interesting. There's 9 best picks, and then there's a list of everything else. Sometimes, depending on your subject, something else is going to be a better use. So, you know, the more you, depending on what you're looking for and different things, and sometimes that's just maybe the question you're having. You say, maybe I'm doing something on this, and I'm not really sure which one I should start with. There's some broad ones. ProQuest Central, you know, is gigantic. But it's not going to have everything you need on a particular subject area depending on what you're looking for. So there's definitely nuances on that. So we'll start with, let's just go to Business Source Premier to start off. Okay, and let's put in, let's do urban, and let's just say, because I want to show you a couple of different things because I don't know if you know this kind of information or not. So we have urban and then here land developed. So what do you notice about the search?
Put a quote.
The quotes, what does that mean? Anybody know what putting quotes around two terms or three terms means?
Exactly.
It means it has to occur that way. So if we were talking about, if we were going to say we're going to be developing the land, it's not going to pick that up. And we also have an asterisk after the P. Does anybody know what that means?
I'll finish the word for you. Development, developers.
Right, it's a truncation. It means that anything after that root word, so it's going to take care of land development, land developers, land develops, develop, everything. Okay, so it kind of, it increases the amount of things you're going to pull up in your search that are still going to be relevant, but you don't have to put in all those different options. Okay, so this is, you can use this, these tools in any kind of searching that you're doing. I'm trying to make it, you know, pertain to you so it makes sense. Okay, any questions about that? Okay. And then we're going to put here an or. And we're going to put, let's do property. Okay, so who can tell me what and does and what or does? Anybody?
And has to be both, or is one or the other, right?
Right. So basically, that's, does everybody understand that? And is the intersection. So you can have one term and another term, and the and is the stuff in the middle. Or is used for synonyms, or for more than one concept that you want to use. So it's going to increase your results using the or. So these are basic search things that you can use wherever you're studying. Whatever. You can use this in Google too, okay? And it's usually capitalized because it's recognized as, it's called Boolean logic. There's actually a Library Learn video on that, so if you forget what I'm talking about, and you can choose. So you can, if we did urban or land development or whatever, we're going to get a gazillion results. If we keep it at and, it's going to have those. Just so you know, in ESCO, which is, that's who the publisher is here, you can click on scholarly peer-reviewed journals, so that will limit it for you right there. Remember we said when you do that in Google Scholar, it's scholarly, but you don't know if it's peer-reviewed. Here you will know that if you click that box. Do not ever click on full text, because you'll get every article that's full text, but you're gonna miss everything else that might be in another database that NOVA has, but it's not full text in this one. So you're gonna limit, I've had students working on their dissertations who've come to the library and said, I can't find anything on my topic. And you're like, really? And what do you, so we go through the process, and let me just tell me what you're doing. And we sit there and we do it, and they click that full text. And it's like, okay, let's unclick that box. And then they're like amazed, because there's a lot out there. So it's one of my tips for the day. Don't click full text. Okay, so then you can just hit search. And have 675 hits. We did not limit to date in this instance. So here's an example. If we had clicked full text, we would not have gotten any of these that say find it. Because find it is going to take you to another journal. So here, like IEEE Technology and Society magazine, okay? When you click on it here, you're just going to get the abstract, and you're going to get some subject terms and some other things, but you're not going to get it. If you click on that find it, here's your best case scenario, okay? It gives you, here's the citation, right? And in here, here's a direct link to that article, because we have it. It's just not in EBSCO. Business Source Premier. It's in IEEE Electronic Library. And here you can click on this link right here and get directly to the article. You can also browse to it if it's something that there's not a direct link, so it'll take you to like that journal and you have to find that particular issue in the volume, which is all listed here at 34, you know, the date. It may take you to Journal Finder, which is now actually that full text finder to help you find it that way. It can maybe have to search NOVACAT But here's the other good thing. So if there's an article and we don't have it, you can then click on this ILiAD. Remember that was the interlibrary loan? And it will populate the entire form for you because it took it from that citation. And all you have to do is then click submit, and then it's done. You don't have to worry about, oh, okay, what was the name of the book? What was the name of it? You don't have to do any of that. So when you do it through the database, it will automatically populate it for you. Any questions about that? Because FindIt is another one of those things that freaks people out. APA, FindIt, going to the library, all those things. We're trying to take the fear out, okay? So, this is going back to 1875. You can just slide this up. So say you wanted maybe the last 10 years. You can just click there and move this over. It's going to update it automatically. And now you have, I guess most of them were hard anyway, because only there was three something before. But you can look through that. You can also go back and modify your search. You can add a line here and keep doing things until you get to the information that you're looking for. Any questions? You're going to be experts, right? Okay, so I'm going to show you the same search in another database so you can see the difference. Okay, so we'll go into ABI Info and Complete, another big database from ProQuest. Okay, we're going to do the same exact search. We're going to do urban here. We're going to do here you have two options. You can do the peer-reviewed and the scholarly, or you can just do scholarly. Okay? We're going to leave the date open. We're going to click search. We have 306. So it's similar, but I guarantee you've got different publications here and different sources. And why is that important? The point of it is to use more than one database because you will get different results because they all have different relationships with publishers. So everything's different. Okay, and then here's also the sliding thing here, so you can go to it goes by decades here. So if we click that and then update, so we're down to 213. Okay, you can, and here's again full text. Here's a find it again because we didn't limit to full text only. You can also go back to this modify search, and then, you know, say you want to limit it to be really about that, and maybe just limit it to the abstract. So there's a lot of tips and tools for, you know, getting your search to be even more exact. So from the 213, then we can go down to 122. And sometimes you get thousands, and you got to keep refining and refining and refining. But a lot of times people have things really tiny, and then they get no results. So sometimes it's just a matter of thinking broad, and you can keep narrow. It's easier to narrow down than just throw back out. Any questions about that? That's how you get a project. okay. So I'm going to go through a couple other ones that I want to show you what's a little different about some of them. Okay. So LexisNexis Academic Business has a lot of interesting things as well. I'm not going to do a search in it. It's a little clunky on searches, but it does have a lot of legal things in there as well, and has a lot of news. So it's important to just get familiar with that one. In Bloomberg BNA, so this is actually, the law school has helped us keep this one. There's some things in here that would be interesting for you to take note of for this class in particular. So they have a lot of reports on the environment and safety. So I know that's one of the things that you're going to be paying attention to, depending on where you go in your career and when you're building. Obviously, the environment is something to consider. There's information on litigation here. There's information on tax and accounting. So these are areas, so this is not your typical type of thing where you might, you know, go to normally do the kind of search that we just did in that kind of database, but there is definitely some information here that would be of use to you in this class and in your other classes here. And you can search, you can click which ones you want to search and do a search through all of them here as well. And then, of course, it's business as well. Access World News. So what's very cool about this, and this was when we were able to save because it was on the cut list. This will give you news from all around the world. So say you're dealing with, you know, if you're doing land development, it's not necessarily in this area, it's some other place, and you want to find out what's going on in that region and know what's going on, you can click on any of the continents, areas. It will list the sources for there, even if some obscure countries. Will give you that local news, and you can see what's going on there. You can search across all of it as well. It's a really cool thing. You can also just search, you know, Florida, there's major metro titles, international newspapers, but it is the most complete of the news databases that we have. So it's really cool for you to narrow it down and get all the way down to whatever you're looking for. So here's one that's going to throw you off, because it's called Science Direct, right? So you're thinking, oh, it's only science, and why is it in the top? So we're going to do a search here, the same one, just so you can see why. Because it just really throws people off. Okay, this one is already scholarly, so you don't even have to limit it to that. It's searching through journals, books, reference works, etc. Questions from West Palm while we're waiting for this?
Nope, no questions, thank you.
Okay. It's taking a while. It's important because I want you to see this.
Well, so much for speedy Wi-Fi.
I know, this is really, I had to, you know, I was looking at this afternoon, and I had to,
so we'll check on that, because clearly if we work here in our classroom, or up in Palm Beach Gardens, we want to make sure we have access to
yes.
What's going on.
While we're waiting for that, I'm going to go back to it, and I'm going to keep going here, so that we're, still going back to my favorite site. We're back to our databases by subject. Well, it's still circling over there, so let's go through a couple of other ones. Okay, so let me see, there's a lot of things here. Okay, demographics now is something we didn't have before, and we got it back through the Florida Library. Resources, so when you are looking for census maps, demographics, graphic type things, it's the basic one, so it's not everything in there, but there's some really good stuff. So you can click on the start now for demographics, you can limit, you know, you can pick your geographic area, see how many, you know, household income, housing units, race, and all these things that would be really useful to you, especially in this class.
Let me ask, has anybody ever used any of these databases before, in any use? Okay, what have you used it for?
I do a lot of like research papers back in undergrad.
Okay, all right. So it's maybe it's a little bit out of context, so that, for example, when you look at something like demographics now, it's all about learning about the market, understanding what the resources are, who your target audience is, who you can sell to, who you can rent to, who will buy. And so those kinds of data points are really valuable. we'll try to make sure that you take advantage of that. When you look at some of these other databases as well, it's to get the information. When I go through the development process, we'll see that when you deal with physical issues, government issues, zoning issues, legal issues, market issues, pricing issues, financial issues, this kind of research can really make you a lot smarter for what you've got to do. And so I know we're kind of dumping this onto you right now up front because you don't have the context, but it's good to know that you have the access and resource to it. And when I get to describing what the development process is and how we will have you all work together in looking at development projects, I think you'll see how this becomes much more valuable.
Yeah, I get that it's kind of like, you know, you haven't even been to the library, right? And so you haven't, it is a little bit, it is a lot. So that's, again, that's why you can go back and schedule an appointment or do whatever you need to do to, I mean, you know, when it comes time and you're like, you said something about that, what was that, you know? So just know that we have the resources here and you have even more that you're gonna get through the real estate program here that are really excellent, really specific to help you. So take advantage. I mean, this is really, this was something that we didn't have even before, but you know, it makes a difference. You're building something somewhere, you know, maybe there's some an ethnic reason why this is a better place for something than not, you know? You know, income is going to affect where, you know, who's going to buy something. Is it high end, low end? You know, if there's people that don't make that kind of money there, you're probably building in the wrong place, right? So you need to look at this kind of information. So there's a lot in here. They do comparisons, and it's a lot of really cool stuff in here. So they actually even have their own tutorials. So if you get stuck, you can kind of play around with it as well. But it's back. Any questions about that? Okay, so. I thought it was done. I'm going to keep going. So we're going to go back to our list because I think there's one or two more that I just want to point out here. Nothing you're going to learn how to get there, right? So we were down to demographics now. JSTOR is another popular one. IntelliConnect for tax information, so federal, state information, tax stuff, you might need to know that as well. And the other one that I really want to point out here, there's also some information in OECD. So this is the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, international statistics on different types of things about the cultures, about education, about health, about all those things that could influence development. So that's a really cool thing there. And let me just fix this. South Florida Business Journal. It's called South Florida Business Journal, but it is more than just South Florida. It is all of the business journals across the country. Okay, so what does that mean? How many of you are familiar with the South Florida Business Journal? Okay, well, you should get more familiar with it because it has a lot of different things in it. Besides all of South Florida, it's also, they do these business journals. Various cities, which is not showing right now. Okay, down here, Albany, Albuquerque, Boston, and even within Florida, there's more than one. There's Jacksonville, there's Tampa, there's a few other areas. I think Orlando. So there's other areas within Florida. There's other business journals. And what this does is it has. So let's just put in real estate right now, and we'll click on South Florida. And you can go into industries, whatever, you hit a search, and so here's like what's going on in real estate. Here's 8 hours ago, 7 hours ago, 11 hours ago. People that are in the business, companies, things going on, kinds of different things that will affect it. And because it's local, you're getting, this is where you're going to get, this is the stuff that's not going to be in something like Business Source Premier or ABI Inform. This is the local, really get to know you. This is also where you can, they have it, and you put in a term and you look. It doesn't do it when you do it like this. Well, they do list jobs here as well. So this is also interesting. So in a particular area, if you did something across all of them, it'll break it down into news, it'll break it down into jobs, it'll break it down to websites, all different types of things, information for you to look for. So you're looking in a particular city, or if you're in another area, you can look at it there. Or search across all of them in a particular thing, looking for a company name. Especially in, you know, property developers and things like that. See what they're doing all over the place. Any questions?
A great resource. I subscribe directly to the South Florida Business Journal, but it's expensive, and that's one of the nice things is since you're already paying a lot of money for this opportunity, take advantage of these resources which are included, if you will.
I also want to point out here the book of lists that's here.
Yes.
We actually have a physical copy of it in the library, but it's online available to you. And what this does is it's like the top 25 fastest growing companies. The top here, it's, you know, if we start opening it up, let's just get me to get to the table of contents here.
Highest property
management. Yeah, they do have construction and design is one of their areas. Real estate is another one of their areas. Well, I'm looking for that. Blow it up.
It's a great resource, so when you think about where you're looking for an opportunity, whether it's for a job or future employment, knowing who's the top in their field, who the people are behind the companies, this is one of those kinds of resources that really bears reading.
Right, so here is commercial, top commercial real estate firms, but it's all the different categories, and you can look through. It's a great resource to have, and as I said, we have Alberto Mendina, who used to work for me years ago. Okay, so here is, listen, we finally got to Science Direct with results. We have, remember we had like 300 and some odd results, right, for in both of those other ones? We have 5,700 in here. Isn't that odd? This is Science Direct. So don't let the name fool you, because it's Elsevier is the publisher. And they do, I mean, they're very international, so you're going to get some things that are really kind of out there. But then you can limit it. So if you can limit it to just urban, there's other types here. You can limit it to just journals. You can limit it to different types. And you hear land use policy, okay? Landscape and urban planning, there's 304 of those. And they have things here that are here actually pre-published. So you can get things already. They have 102 articles for 2016. That's like unheard of, right? That's not happening in any other publisher's field right now. So don't let the name Science Direct fool you, because you will find things that will help you there. Especially when you get into really scholarly stuff that's really useful. Okay. I think I covered pretty much what I wanted to cover. Are there any burning questions? So I just want to do a quick review here to let you know, again, ask a librarian to make your appointments or call us or stop by or do whatever you need to do. The databases, the catalog, information about the hours, directions of parking, everything is in here. It really made it, it's a little bit more user-friendly, I would say, right now, this database. I mean, the home page, still a few things a little quirky about it, but for the most part, I think you'll find it pretty useful. So just know that we're here to help. So in the back, just so again, let me just repeat that I left a thing about these workshops, so grab these during your break. The collaborative study room, take advantage of that. Come over and see it sometime, really, just stop by. And Google Scholar, and I left a couple of my business cards back there as well, so feel free to take those.
All right, great, thank you.
try. But she will liven it up when you need the information. Okay? Great. Thank you.
Hope you didn't think that was dry. I'm not your typical librarian.
Some of my best friends are librarians. So let's reconnect my computer. And we'll see what we can bring up online here.
Oh, where's that sign-in sheet? Did everyone sign that? No.
Yes,
yeah.
Here it is.
Is there anyone that didn't get it?
Everybody signed the sheet?
Oh,
okay, I'll pass it.
Palm Beach Gardens, can you see the PowerPoint presentation now back on the screen?
Yep.
Yep.
Okay, great, thank you. Super. Okay, so we're going to change things up just a little bit right now. And we're going to look at a video. And I want you to look at this video and listen. It's going to run for about a minute or so. And then I want you to think about what is happening as you watch this video. And we'll get participation from you up in Palm Beach County as well. And so look carefully, think about what you're looking at. Technique, okay. Of course, you've all played softball or baseball before. Okay, what's your name?
Antoine.
Antoine, there we go.
Yes. Participation of each other team members.
Okay, all right, so we'll just call it the participation team, okay. Yes,
Charlene.
What's your name again?
Charlene.
Charlene, okay.
Pretty much a three-step process.
Three steps, what are they?
The three bases, like I noticed that they kept going like first base, second base, third base, sometimes they would switch the bases.
Okay, all right, so there's a process here. It doesn't really matter how many steps, but at least we know something had to be done that was part of all of that, okay? Yes, what's your answer?
Working together, or teamwork.
Okay, so just general teamwork, okay. All right, let's see, anything else? Let's go back to Jordan.
Coordination.
Coordination, were they coordinated? Some of them were. What if they didn't get it? That's they'd have trouble, wouldn't they? Let's see if I can even spell here, coordination. Let's see, Gayon, you already said something. I want to make sure everybody has a chance to say something. How about in West Palm Beach, anything up there? Yes.
Well, my tutor said people working together to accomplish a common goal and a team executing.
Okay, all right, so goals and objectives.
Accomplish a common
goal. All right, that's
yeah.
Great. Good, thank you. Anything else for the other individual up there? What's your name again?
Yes, my name is Jason. Rules, there's rules to the game.
Okay, all right, that's interesting, great. Not obvious necessarily, but somebody's got to have some kind of organizational effort here. Any other comments? Yes, Harold.
And there were a lot of moving parts, and they were all following a certain... I mean, there are a lot of people involved here, and a lot of moving parts, of, I guess, trying to accomplish.
Yeah, okay. All right, Gayon, you had some something else you were going to mention.
Every game started with a pitch.
Pardon?
Every game had a pitch.
All right, so... I'll just call it the pitch,
yeah.
If you will. Pitch, you can't even spell it right. Okay, great. All right, look, that's enough for now. It's interesting just to hear what people say, because when you're looking at a ball game or any kind of teamwork, you're going to see different things that are going on, right? And, of course, I'm using this as a metaphor in some way, shape, or form for what the development process is all about. So we'll go back to the live screen. Hopefully it will come up. Yes, this is what you all said. And, of course, I put up some other items here too, which are the kinds of things that I saw. And so it's not just about the game, but when you think about development, when you think about the real estate process, you've got to have all these different items in there. So teamwork, coordination, desire to win, individual efforts, these are comments that the previous class actually said last semester. And it's always interesting to see what people say because it tells me what they're thinking and what their focus is. And so this is one way to look at real estate. It's all about the team. And as we go through our semester, you're going to find that the different parts of the process require the team and teamwork to fit together in certain ways. So hopefully you'll get the feel of that too as well. So let's talk about, and that was just a little diversion for a moment, let's talk about what this course really is going to be about and what I'm going to try to accomplish with you over the next 8 weeks. So, all right, we're focusing on real estate. We're going to go through, at least this evening, the different stages, the different phases of the real estate development process. By the way, for my education, how many of you are actively involved in some way, shape, or form in real estate right now? I'm going to look good. We have a lot of hands. Uh-oh, they're in the majority, so that's good. All right, so I want to ask what kind of real estate you're in, because I'll confess, I didn't have a chance. Often I like to go onto LinkedIn and look everybody's name up and profile, but a little bit of crunch time, I didn't do it. So let's just start up in West Palm Beach. I'm curious, don't give me your curriculum vitae. I'm just curious, what part of the business are you in or what have you been involved in? What, the two of you, Jason, you start.
I've been in residential real estate and commercial real estate, actually, since 2003.
Okay, great. All right. And I'm not going to remember your name.
Alex.
Yes, okay.
That's okay. Residential and commercial leasing and sales for the last 4 years.
Okay, all right, great. That's interesting. Let's talk about here. Who here, by the way, let me just, by show of hands, how many of you actually are realtors or brokers or sales associates? All right, so we have four hands here, and the two of you up there. Okay, great. So that's interesting. Six out of the 16 in the class. How many of you have been actively involved in some part of construction or building? All right, another 4 or 5 of you. Okay, good. And hands raised up there. Look, they're winning the game right here. Okay. What other aspect? How many of you have been actually involved in marketing or market analysis? Okay. How about the legal side of the business? Anybody a budding lawyer? No, good. We'll stay away from the lawyers for now. That's good. Unfortunately, you're going to have to tangle with them in some way, shape, or form in the business. And I've got to tell you, I don't have a law degree, but I'm the one who tells the lawyers what to do. Okay? And you'll tell the lawyers what to do, and I know this is being recorded, and if the lawyers look at this, we'll simply say, well, they helped to get the deal done. You still, as the real estate developer, have to direct and manage that process. So, any other disciplines, any other parts of the business that I'm missing? Yes. Okay, great. So planning, architecture, anybody in that side of the world? Okay, we have a few people there. By the way, I happen to have an architecture degree. I'm a licensed architect. But way, 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 way back, by the way, I started when I played with my first Lego set. When I was 5 years old, my family moved to Sweden, of all places, so I'm much older than you are, back in the 20th century, and they had Lego, and we went to Legoland in Denmark, and wow, I was just blown away. And of course, that was my introduction to real estate. Of course, now it's just kind of in my genes, I just kind of like go like this, and it just shakes through. And so, when you think about those various processes, yes, architecture, planning, and design, that's part of who I am. I also went to business school. I'm just giving you a little bit about my CV so you understand who I am. So, yes, I played with my Lego when I was a kid. I had my dad, thank goodness he took all those pictures of me, my brother, my sister. That got me into architecture school, and I went there after I went to Harvard undergraduate, and I majored in economics. Anybody here an economics major from undergraduate? All right, we see one hand, nothing up north, okay. The dismal science, right? What did you learn?
I don't remember anything.
Oh, there we go. Okay. All right. And so, all right, but you know, it's interesting. Jordan just mentioned it. Sometimes it's not the specifics of what you learn, but the process of what you learn. And so as we go through this particular course, you know, I'm not going to ask that you remember that, you know, a particular zoning code was XYZ in Fort Lauderdale or wherever it might be, because that's always changing. The facts on the ground will change. But it's how you use that information. Of course, I took my degree at Harvard, okay, it's in economics, and I said, what does that give me a grounding? It's a platform. Everything we're doing here is a platform for your future work and career and your interests. Of course, from there, I went to architecture school. I said, gee, I wanted to be someone who would really figure out what was going on. In fact, I remember vividly when I was undergraduate, I went to speak.